let's get started. But there is a custom that we follow before we get started with any talk. I would just casually take a pic and with the community. This one?
Yeah.
I think, yeah. So we are good. This talk is basically about a concept, a use case that is on Elastic Stack. How many of you know Elasticsearch or heard about ELK? Yeah, obviously. Yeah, OK. That's really good. I can talk more and brief you more about while I'm talking what is this and how is this about. So I'm Aravind. I work at Elastic as a developer advocate. I look after the developer relation function of India and a bit of Southeast Asia as well. So my work is to talk at conferences, meetups, and look after the open source community, help developers achieve their goals and like succeed in using Elastic Stack as altogether. So today we are basically looking. This is the agenda that we have today. We'll see what is this stack and like. What is APM? So I didn't talk about APM, right? So let's see what is this, what is the word APM, and what is all about APM, and why we should use it, and what it can do, and a bit about demo, and like how you should work with it, and how you can make use of this solution that I'm talking about. So before going to this, this is the Elastic Stack, all new, 6.3. We just released a day before. And yeah, I mean, Elasticsearch is the heart and soul of this stack. And I don't know how many of you know about Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is a search engine which helps you to do search or analytics on the data that you have. So it's like a NoSQL distributed REST-based search engine. It's open source. The entire stack that you see here is open source under Apache 2.0 license. You have Beats and Logstash, which are the ingestion modules, which helps you to ingest the data from various sources. Suppose Logstash is like your data enricher, or like ETL tool, if you know about ETL. ETL does extract, transform, and load. So it pulls data from various sources, like any RDBMS servers, or any server-based systems, or anything which contains API, like a Twitter tweets or Facebook posts. And it transforms the data and pushes to Elasticsearch. Beats is a latest addition to entire Elastic Stack, after which we started calling it a stack rather than ELK. So Beats is a lightweight data shipper which helps you to ship data from any source, mostly from your servers to your Elasticsearch. So all these push data to Elasticsearch. Between Elasticsearch also has REST APIs, which can help you to like take data. You can use the regular API to talk to Elasticsearch as well. And Kibana is a window into Elasticsearch. It helps you to visualize the data. It helps you to get the insights from the data that you are pushed into Elasticsearch. You can run aggregations. You can run visualizations on top of the data that you pulled in Elasticsearch, and then see what is happening in your data real time. This is about the stack. Then what is this? I mean, XPack, right? That generally we have at the boot. XPack is the commercial offering from Elastic. So effective 2 days back, XPack is open under custom EULA that we have. Like you can see the code, you can look into the code, and you can also contribute back if you're interested. You can talk to us about what we have in the store. We provide additional capabilities that you can solve, you want to solve with Elastic. Suppose security or like monitoring, or you want to monitor your stack, or if you have some use case related alerting, like threshold alerting. All this could be possible with the entire XPack feature. And XPack also has a free tier, like you can freely use it, just getting installed and all. So with 6.3, the XPack magic comes into Elastic Stack altogether, and like you can play around with it. Okay, enough of stuff, right? What is APM, and what are the various use cases? So Elasticsearch can help you to do all of these till now. There are various use cases of Elastic altogether, but one of the newest and use case to this addition to this entire stack is APM. APM is nothing but application performance monitoring and management. So it helps you to manage and monitor your apps, what's happening inside your apps, are there any errors that you are looking at, all sorts of stuff. We'll look into briefly about what is this and how it operates. So what is APM, right? So APM is blah, 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 and all. By this time, you might be having this look at me like, OK, this guy started putting a lot of text, and I don't know where to go. Maybe it's time to look at the door. But not exactly. I'll try to explain it in a way that you would understand, maybe a story kind of thing. On a Saturday morning or a Friday evening, you might be deploying. This is generally what developers do is like deploy the application, do production release, and like sit and enjoy, like, okay, it's done, right? I have done an effort and everything is working, I'm happy. But while you are done and relaxing at this point, you might see something like this, right? An internal server error, which you didn't expect. By the time you come back, things start going crazy, right? Everyone try to stop the flares, and like application doesn't work, and your business is calling you, and all sorts of stuff, right? So this is a typical scenario, and you feel that nothing works, right? All the time you try to fix everything, and nothing responds to you. But then you try to fix somehow, get things stable. You removed your fixes, or you did something, and then you somehow debugged it. But then this happens, right? The page doesn't load in, and you fix something, something else comes up. So this is a typical scenario for any developer, right? On any release or any day, right? This is how we battle. And then you open all of these to look and debug and find out what is what. And by this time you will be having this sort of face like, okay, the debugging is done, right? I'm not going to do any more. It's done for this day. So these are the problems that I face myself in any development. I'm myself a developer. I code in Java, so I know how difficult it is like to find out a problem and like go ahead and solve it, and again deploy, see another thing, and like, okay, let's go back. All the time that I spent is gone for wasted. I have to do again. So you need to have some sort of a tool or someone who could help you. I always feel this and help you to make better or like reduce the time that you debug. So Elastic Stack has come up with something called APM. APM is not new, it's always there. There are several other solutions, but the Elastic's APM is addition to the existing use cases that you already have. You might be using Elastic for some search in your application, or you might be using it for some sort of logging or business analytics use case. But APM is a fresh addition. What it can do a lot of things. I will talk about it. But how APM works, APM integrates with your application internally and sends in data or sends in error points so that you could debug or reduce your debugging time. So APM is 100% open source. It's under Apache 2.0 license. There's a UI ready-made in Kibana. We will see that today in the demo. And there are language agents. How it basically works is like it integrates with each. Suppose you write applications in languages, programming languages. We have additional libraries which integrate into your code base and like sends data frequently or in a time-based interval. So currently we have support for Python, for Django and Flask frameworks, and there are several other language agents that are available right now, like the Java, and Java is in alpha, and Ruby is in beta, and you have Node.js in GA, JavaScript as in GA, everything, and Python is GA as well. So you can go ahead and try to use it in your applications. So how it really works, so there are the application libraries which are integrated into your Python or Django app. It's a simple one-line statement, and you just need to put in your settings file. And then it talks to something called APM server, which sends the data or the traces of your application and all the requests or API calls. And then it which comes to Elasticsearch. Thereby you will be able to see all sorts of response and request codes. So this might be a bit difficult at this point of time too, because there's a lot of jargons, there's a lot of names here which you might not be able to understand, but we will see in the demo and we will see what's happening. So what APM can do? APM can do all these things. Like, it can help you to monitor your application, what's happening inside. It helps you to trace your code. And it also helps you to reduce the overall debugging time because it finds the errors to the code point. You can see what's happening in your code. So let's see, go ahead and see the demo. So I have downloaded the Elasticsearch Kibana and the APM server from the site, and then I just running this black box in my own development system in the system system. So these are available on GitHub as well. You can go ahead and see and look into the code. And this is the agent that we are looking at today. So this agent is, you can compile it by yourself, but otherwise you can download it from the download space as well. So there is a documentation, brief documentation about it, but I would prefer you use this application today, because this is an application, sample one that we built on top of the agent that we have today. So you just need to fork this application, and then you can see the data flowing into Elastic without any hassle. So we have a Docker Compose file as well. If you have Docker installed in your system, you can just run the Docker Compose file, just say one command, and things start up automatically. So alternatively, if I have to tell you what is happening inside, I can show you. So I have downloaded, this is very small, I understand. So I have downloaded an Elasticsearch instance. I just entered into that directory, and I entered into bin, and I started doing this, like Elasticsearch. I start this command here, and I have to run three particular command line instances, because it's the same laptop. I am running all the products on the same machine. So I have to run Elasticsearch, Kibana, and the APM server, and my application, Python application as well. So in production systems, ideally, it won't be that case. You will run each in a separate environment. You might have a farm of servers where your Python application might be running. And you might have a cluster with like 10, 15 nodes where your Elasticsearch is running. So I have just used a Docker Compose file, which is there here in this in this GitHub repo. It's there right away, and you can just you need to have Docker. That's the only prerequisite, and things come up automatically without you doing anything. So let us see the application first. How does it look, and what are the various things that are there, right? So let's go to dev. I have a workspace, and then beans Python, right? So this is the demo app that I have. It's written in Django, and I mean it's powered by Django library and like a framework. I have a settings.py here, which contains all the settings today. Let me open with the text so that you will see what's there inside. So I have the APM agent, which I am talking about, injected into the app settings. It's just an import library, and you just like a jar for a Java file or a package for Python. You just need to install it and then put it in your settings file where it traces all your application code. So there are some more settings that you could do. Like there are all sorts of optimizations that you could do. Like suppose you don't want to send every request coming to your Python application to the somewhere, like to the Elasticsearch. If you want to restrict it and sample the interval for every 10 seconds, you can do that as well. You can redact passwords. You can only push content that you want to push, and you can stop which you don't want to do. Suppose, if you see here, I have a Elastic APM variable where I take the service name. So every application is named, and like you would see, suppose you have a 20 servers running for a Python application, then the service that we are monitoring should be the same one, right? So however your application. So we have a service name. For each service name, how many servers you have, it collocates into the same index, it collocates into the same data store, like think of a SQL table for understanding purpose. It pushes the data into same place, wherein you can see analytics and data running on top of it. So this is my Python application, and let me show you my Kibana or the UI that I have built on top of it. So I just ran this app. It's running. I just did .manage/py run server, and just it runs up, and then you see the server running. So this is the application that I have. It's a e-commerce application. Okay. Oh, okay. Let me try to run it. Yeah, see, you see 8,000 coming up here. So yeah, this is a sample application that we have seen on GitHub. So this is nothing but a e-commerce or a coffee store where there are several types of coffees. And when I click here, I would see what the user is interacting with, what sort of latency that each page is responding, are there any errors. If there are any errors that occur in the production, I would be able to see all of this. Like, sounds funny, right? So how would I do it, really? Just with the agent, right? You can really do it. So this is a service that we are monitoring, which is there on top of that. And this is the data that is being generated from the same application that we have. So the data is simple. It is, okay, let us. It shows you everything related to your response times, or how many requests are coming, and how many 200s are there, how is the latency, how much my server is working on each and everything. It also shows you what UI or the what view is being clicked more, right? And how much the response time is taking in. All of these done automatic without you doing anything. You just need to run these instances and like connect your app with the appropriate agent and give what is the URL that you are pointing at. That's all done. And it simply works up. And if you want to do a demo, you can use the Docker file as well for the understanding purpose. You can also see, get into each view and see how that particular view is responding, like each page in your Django app, like what is the request duration and how is the request response. And wonderfully, you can also see what is the SQL queries that are being executed in that particular request. Like it goes to, suppose we are running multiple queries inside the request, and it is causing a bottleneck. You can see what happens, where the bottleneck is there, or which table is taking a lot of time, or which table is taking time to respond, whether you could optimize it or to improve the application as well. So these are the things that you could do. But I spoke about errors. I mostly spoke about the errors and like the debugging part, right? So it also looks at your errors that are occurring in your service. Suppose there is an error that is a number pass exception. You can go ahead and see this particular error when it has occurred. It's been occurring over a period of time, like whenever the customer is trying to enter some value into a field, this sort of error is occurring. So I could see when it has occurred. I could also see the trace that is being happened. I can also see what is the system that is customer is trying to run, and what is the request parameters that has come in with this particular request when this error is occurred. So your debugging is like very light. You know what's the error, how it is occurring, what is the variable types, everything, right? So you also have the exception stack trace, most importantly. If you open this library frames, you see it starts from the base.py, and it goes to like, it goes all to the process, and like it goes everywhere and where it is going on. So it's a checkout.py. Like whenever you check out the product, you are filling your address or the details related to your billing address. Then at that point, there is a phone number field, it seems, in my application, where the person has to enter a number, but instead he is entering a text, which that means I didn't validate it, or the validation somehow got screwed up because of some reason that I've deployed a new application version. So that's why this error is occurring. And you could see completely come down and see like where this particular error is being happened. See, there is a phone number util in the utils where I am getting a number pass exception. All this thing which I am talking about, you can try to simulate it by yourself as well using the open source app. This is a sample app that we developed. You can take that as a basis and start integrating your code. There are some customers already got or some open source community users who have used this and like got good benefits, because as and when the errors come up in their production systems, they could able to find out and fix it in a very less time because of the granularity of the error being reported. So these are the things that you could simply do with the Elastic Stack or the APM solution that we have today. But also there is an important point here, like all this is good, but what I can't do, right? What you can't do with APM, you can't do all of these with APM. this is not intended to do this. It's only for application. It's not for your infrastructure monitoring. Suppose what's happening at your server level, like CPU consumption, memory consumption, or how many threads are running at CPU level, that's not part of it. It can't do log analytics. It can't push your logs to Elasticsearch. That can't be done. It can't also detect security attacks that are happening on your application because it comes at a different level called network, right? So you need to use different tools. But does Elastic provide anything for that? Yes, we do. We do have everything for developers to take advantage of these. So all of this is open source, right? I am not talking about anything and everything about commercial here. Everything is open source. You can go ahead and use it, fork it, modify it to your way that how you want. So we have Beats and like Logstash, which is something that, okay, this is not working, fine. So you have Beats and Logstash, which is for logging, which ships your logs or other related data. We have server level monitoring, which enables you to do all sorts of this. And then you have application level monitoring with APM, like customized language agents, which we spoke about just now. All this could help you to do more and monitoring the full end-to-end pipeline of your infrastructure, like the network, disk, and the compute, or the application to the higher level as well. So these are the references. If you want to learn or do more, I know that in a big conference like this, you can't see everything. And I made a URL. If you want to look and refer to documentation, refer to videos like this where it will explain you tutorials, all the stuff, you can go ahead and hit this link and you would get all the links that I pasted there and boom. But still you have doubts, we are happy to discuss. We just beside the door, and we have all sorts of stickers if you want, and we are happy to help on any other use case that you have. So that's it from my side. Thank you. And most importantly, if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer here.
Anyone have questions?
In Django, do they have plan to implement on another Python framework application?
So you meant to say Flask?
Yes, such as Falcon or?
So right now we have support for some frameworks. We didn't try and test on all the Python frameworks, but as and when community validates more and more frameworks, suppose you could try it out and say it to us, because we do tests for Django and automations are testing enabled for these frameworks. That's why we came out and say it works for Django, it works for Flask, right? This is mostly used frameworks. But if you are interested, you can log a issue and say the concern, and probably we could look into it as well if the framework is. What is the framework that you are saying?
Falcon.
Yeah, I think it's famous as well, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, we will try to test it as well. Okay. But we didn't come and openly support it as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Okay.
If my application just have some error from the show you are in Kubernetes, how I know that this application, this error is fixed?
I couldn't get some parts of your question. Like if your application is facing some error or problem, how do you know? How do you know? What is that?
Like if I fix this problem, I can put to dashboard or remove this issue from your monitoring, like remove from Kubernetes.
How do you mark? No, so this is a reporting, like wherein the data is coming from your application, and you could see it, and you could develop integrations with your Jira or the ticketing system that you have, like Bugzilla or various other things using some of the integrations that we have. But we don't have anything to mark it as resolved. But it will show you what are the errors. When you deploy again, the error gets resolved, right? But it doesn't have such system where you can log, mark a resolved or something like that.